Okay, so today I'm talking to Ken Wilson, who's here at the Jolt Conference in Tokyo, Japan, and he's just given a wonderful plenary speech about motivation. So I'm not going to ask you to summarise the whole thing, but could you tell us what's the main message that you'd like people to take away?
I think, funny, the main message is something I don't actually say in the talk, because I don't want to make it sound like a downer, but there's no question to my mind that wherever you go in the world at the moment, there's a sense of things being not quite right with the world, and when you're dealing with like student age learners, like 17, 18, 19, who are now looking at what they're going to do for the rest of their life, there seem to be less certainties around now than maybe there were 10 years ago in terms of the obvious progression. And this is just about everywhere you go in the world. Students who are taking their studies seriously and they're learning English seriously as part of their studies, what's ahead of them seems to have crumbled a little bit. So what I'm looking at really in terms of motivation is you obviously can't go in knowing that your students will sit there going, I'm learning English because it's really important to me as a person, it's important to the world in terms of communication. They're not feeling that way anymore because they're not feeling particularly positive. So you've got to make the classroom experience a kind of microcosm of its, in its own right. So when you walk into that room, it's not that you're learning English, it's that you're being together and doing the kind of thing where you communicate with each other well and you find interesting stuff to talk about. And the atmosphere is nice in that little microcosm.
Okay,
I suppose that's the message.
Yeah, it was nice. It was a very kind of energizing plenary, so I appreciate that. Thank you. So the questions I wanted to ask you about mainly today is, of course, you're well known as a materials writer. So I wanted to ask you about textbooks, of course. So one of the things I wanted to ask you, first of all, what do you think makes a good textbook? It's a big question.
Right. Well, there's the obvious... You want to open a book that you think you'd have fun looking at yourself in terms of the content. I think it's quite easy to produce a good-looking book that the students will be quite happy to open and work from. I think the really important thing, and I hope this is what I've been able to do over the last two or three sets of books that I've written, is that I try much harder. I mean, I always try to write a reasonable book, but nowadays, because I've been writing a lot more material for elementary level, for example, is to try and process particularly what the editorial teams want in terms of outcomes and output from the students, whether it's spoken or written, in terms of what they actually can do. That makes sense?
Yes.
So in other words, they will say, well, why can't they sort of give their opinion about something? Mm. Say, okay, giving your opinion actually requires saying, I think. Mm. And we haven't actually taught that yet. Mm-hmm. So what should we do? Shall we just put a little note here saying, from now on, we want the students' opinions. They're 18, 19 years old. They will have opinions. Mm. But we haven't taught them opinion strategies yet. Mm-hmm. Let's think about the importance of that, and try and step back a bit to see what the students need to be able to say what the task requires. And so I found this wonderful task once in a book that I was looking at somebody else's book. And it said, put your students in pairs. It was, shows you how old the book was. We were talking about CDs and cassettes. And it said, put your students in pairs and ask them to ask each other about how many CDs and cassettes they have. That complicated. And you think, what's the outcome of that? How many CDs do you have? 5. How many do you have? 3. That's it. There's not much there. The language requirement is quite basic, but there's nothing else to say. So that really is not enough of a, and it seems like quite a big speaking outcome suggestion, but it's not enough. And in some cases, the requirement is too much. So what I think makes a good course book is the things you don't really see. It's the thinking behind it, the kind of research that goes into how students can deal with the tasks we're giving them.
So how do you make a book into a book rather than just a collection of activities and exercises? How do you get that cohesion, do you think?
That's a very good question. I think, I'm sure different authors have different ways of doing it, and author teams have different ways. But you see, my most recent book is this book, Smart Choice, an American English course basically for Asia. And I didn't have a lot of experience of Asia before that. And the editorial team in New York were amazing. Mm. They sat down and said, these are the circumstances of the students we're talking about. Mm. Right, now where do we go from here? Let's have an overview of what we'd really... I mean, again, it's all about, I keep using the word outcomes and output. Mm. It's what do you want this book to... What do you want to be able to do after they've used this book? Mm. And are we going to what are we going to do for topics? Let's try and avoid the most obvious topic, vocabulary, grammar, link-ups and stuff. I don't know, it's a series of conversations with people, mm. and out of that comes an idea, comes in a framework, if you like. Mm. By the time you start writing, you've got, obviously, most books will want some kind of grammar spine to it, a lexical spine to it as well, but on top of that, you want a kind of a feel, what you want the people to do with it at the end, you know. I don't think it's very easy to explain it in a few words, but what was nice with this going from... The Oxford gang, I'd never worked at Oxford before, was the fantastic kind of input from the editorial team and the people in the different markets saying what they thought we wanted. Mm. Smart Choice came about because Oxford felt they didn't have a book that was adult and simple. Mm. You know, the students who do this compulsory year of English here in university, there wasn't really an Oxford book that provided them with adult-looking material, but a kind of an... elementary output requirement.
That is often a gap in the market, actually. I mean, I remember many years ago when I first started teaching, I worked for a language school chain here in Japan, and actually they produced their own textbooks, and they were very good because they were so directed. But the problem we had was that not only the language that became more complex throughout the series, but also, you know, the characters and the illustrations, and the thing that was awful was that the lowest level books were just very childish. Mm. But you would have, you know, very high powered business people, for example, coming in to learn from these books. But
the choice of illustration, I mean, these are really important things, you know, that somebody who's an elementary level bank manager or something goes, that's a cartoon, you know. Yeah. Getting cartoon material, which every book needs cartoon material to provide a vocabulary focus or some kind of focus like that. It's got to be really spot on. Although, actually in Asia, adults do like comics more than they do in other countries. So if you get a manga-esque sort of feel to the cartoons, you get them. But you're right, you open a book and go, it's a children's book.
This is for kids, yeah. Okay. So the other thing I wanted to look at... when I did the Delta, and one of the things I enjoyed most of doing the Delta was evaluating textbooks and learning how to look at a textbook and understand what the writer was thinking and what he or she wanted to do with it. So what would your advice be for someone who's picking up a textbook and deciding what they should do?
Well, that's an interesting thing you say that. I mean, it's like the whole thing of if you read a poem and you come up with the explanation and you tell the explanation to the poet, and the poet says... Well, that's not what I had in mind at all. Mm-hmm. Does that make the evaluation by the reader of the poem invalid? And I don't think it does. I mean, it's all about how you respond to it. And I think, we talk about the flick test, you know, that teachers will go to a conference like this and they'll go around and go, yeah, this is nice. There's something about, it's okay. Mm. And that really is a little bit beyond what the author had. That's about the design, you know. But I always compare, this is probably not quite answering your question, but I always compare it to, you see a facade on a restaurant, it looks like a nice place, and you go in, you don't like the food, you don't go back.
Yeah.
Right? So the design will not carry a book through 5 years of its life.
No,
you know.
No.
It's all about content then at the end of the day. Sorry, let's get back to the original answer to that question. I think if a teacher says, I love your book because I think that they think the listings are all really funny, and you go, okay, that's great. Yeah, that wasn't what I expected, you know. But if it's what you make of it, you know, we are not artists; we're artisans. Mm. You know, if you get, you might get somebody who makes tables, right? And he says, look, I think three-legged tables are just so cool. Mm. I think two legs at one end, one leg at the other. It's just a really nice idea. Mm. We'll go, I don't want a table like that. Mm. So that guy goes out of business, right? Same with materials. There was a materials meeting today, and somebody made a very, very good... You weren't there, were you?
No.
Right. And there were four people who were all involved in kind of online publishing, local publishing, small-scale publishing. Really interesting people, because that's a whole other area we could talk about, how the the opportunities for providing materials are so vast now, and you and your desktop can produce them. But bear in mind, what works for you in a classroom and you think is brilliant may not work for anybody else, any other teacher. And therefore, he made a really good point. If you want to publish materials, give it to somebody else to try. At least one other bit, and then a few other people. And if they come back and say, I don't quite see how this works, realize that's not, it's not so much a criticism, it's just an observation that it might not work beyond the way you do things. You know, this is a real problem for me, because I quite enjoy animating a class and getting it rolling. I mean, like, I've just done as you saw in my presentation, I did an awful lot of talking. I did more talking in that 45 minutes I would want to do in 45 minutes in a class. I want to get stuff going, get people in groups, do stuff, make them feel part of what's going on, you know? And that's my way. I like to walk around and be a busy, noisy, enthusiastic presence. Not everybody teaches like that, you know? And there are many, many different ways to teach. And if you think, no, I think people need a quieter approach. Well, maybe they do from you. But if you're looking to produce materials, you've got to find a way that, you know, that other people can use it as well. I'm rambling a bit here on some of these answers.
I like that. I was looking through, I was doing a little bit of research before the interview, and I found, which I've read before, a Dick Allwright article from ELT Journal in 1981. You're probably familiar with it, actually. It's called, it's a rather provocative title, is What Do We Want Teaching Materials For?
1981,
yes. But it's quite interesting. He's got two views. There's a difference view. And he says that teachers, that textbooks free the teacher from decision-making in certain areas, and then that allows them to focus on intrapersonal things and classroom management and those kind of important things. So that's a positive view. But there's also the deficiency view, which he kind of called teacher-proofing. It's like, here's a book, just do it. It's, you know, any idiot can do this. Just follow the steps. Now, of course, you have a positive view of materials in general, but what do you think about this teacher-proofing idea?
Well, essentially, that's 1981. That's 20 years before Dogma, the first Dogma article.
I wasn't going to say the D word.
No, but that's it. I didn't realise somebody had written something quite like that. I mean, the fact of the matter is, you can see materials as a straitjacket. No question about it. You can see a book as a straitjacket. And if you are in a position to work without a book, then I think you should. If you want to, if you find books a straitjacket and you are in a position, in other words, if your class are not heading to some kind of an exam, which really you could do with some materials to help with, or even if they are and you're going to go online or find a testing device or something for that, to start just with the, you know, I mean, the whole Dogma principle of going in there and just finding out what there is to play with. Now, I'm a big fan of Scott and Luke, and I think it's a great book that they've written, and I love what they do. But there are two obvious things to face up to. One is level, and there's not a lot of emergent language coming out of it. Whatever they say, there's not a lot of emergent language out of an elementary class. But far more important is something that Jack Richards referred to in his plenary today, is that the whole idea that he put it quite bluntly, that around the world, the vast majority of English teachers, of course, are non-native speaker teachers, and the reality is that their level is upper intermediate and no better, if you look at it as an average.
Yeah.
Now, and that's fine, as Jack pointed out, that's absolutely fine, as long as they can teach, and they have good teaching methods. And it's actually much better to be a non-native speaker teacher who knows how to teach to people who speak her own language than a backpacker who just rolls in. That's obvious, right? Yeah. But I think that and I don't want to put anti-dogma, but the materials-based argument is heavily in favour of those non-native speaker teachers who would feel a bit at sea if they were only dealing with emergent language or only dealing with, you know, whatever they could put together from materials they... You know, that's why I think... I would say from my most recent experience of using somebody else's book in a classroom, which is quite some time ago now, that I didn't think of it as a straitjacket. I did see that this is a bit empty, this unit. I'm going to have to add to it. But the book was always really useful to have there, even for me as a native speaker and, you know, fairly kind of noisy and imaginative person.
Personally speaking, I prefer to use a textbook, but, which is actually leading on to my next question, I rather have a kind of minimal textbook. because the straitjacket term, I've chosen books like that before, which look wonderful, and you get CD-ROMs, and you get websites, and you get, they'll make tests for you, and there's a resource book, and then, and I realise, I've only got 90 minutes, what am I going to do, what do I bring to this lesson? And those kind of books kind of, I find...
But I think the advantage of, because you're describing basically the most modern, the latest versions of most of the textbooks that are out there now.
Yes, I know.
Has all this extra stuff. But it's just there if you need it, and it's there as a student resource. I think that's the really good stuff about online now, is how much you can send them away, you know, and as I mentioned in my talk, this is not planned material, but the way in which things like wikis, that organising a class wiki is re-engaging students who feel a bit kind of left behind by the traditional approach. Same way, that online stuff, there may be students in your class think, well, I think I'd rather spend a bit of time online doing that. I sometimes find the whole thing of being surrounded by other students a bit pressurising and being told to talk to that one and get into groups. Some students find that a bit difficult. They're the ones who, when you say, if you want, there's all this stuff online. Go and do it for yourself. It's there if you need it. It's not more for you to deal with yourself.
No. Yeah. I understand that intellectually, but emotionally I sometimes feel that, which is why I don't use so many of those kind of books anymore, that once I've got that much stuff, it's a shame to waste it. It's what they call motainai in Japanese.
Okay.
It's like, you know, waste not, want not kind of thing. Well, I've got it, and, you know, the students have got this stuff.
That is a separate problem. I mean, the thing is now that this, it's quite difficult to keep talking about a paper book as the only resource.
Yes.
But in the days when it was the only resource, and I spent a lot of time watching other teachers at work, and you can see them thinking, I don't really want to do that. So they jump over an activity which they feel a bit uncomfortable with, and the students say, you haven't done activity six, you know. They notice it, and that could be a problem.
It's all right not to do activity six,
absolutely,
right? If you don't want to do it.
No, I'm just saying, it's the students who say, teacher, why didn't we do that?
I can say, I know.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, well, I'd like to talk a little bit. Actually, sorry, before I forget, there was one thing I was interested in the plenary. Well, there are a lot of things, but one thing I noted down was that you talked about using L1 in the class positively. You think it's a good thing.
Absolutely.
So can you expand on that a little bit?
Well, I think there's a wider thing to do with the success of UK published books. I get into trouble saying things against publishers
sometimes.
Sure, we
can edit later.
No, but I feel very strongly about this. That since about the 1970s, when the sales of course books produced in the UK and then later on produced in the US, which are entirely in English, rubrics in English from day one, book one, everything's in English, right? And alongside this comes this kind of belief. You are shortchanging your students if they don't spend their entire time speaking English in the time that you're with them, right? And it's that's why all our instructions are in English as well. The fact of the matter is, the instructions are in English so we can sell the same book in Brazil, in Japan, whatever, right? That's the reason it's all in English from day one, level one.
Mm.
And frankly, I think those days are past now. And I think the fact is, I mean, like, have you ever tried learning Hungarian? You know, we decided to learn Hungarian, my wife and I, because we spent so much time in Hungary. And we got a book we found in London, and all the explanations were in English, and it was really very reassuring.
Yes.
You know, and I'm afraid that's actually quite true of a lot of students, especially elementary students. We are being a bit unfair on them, not to give them books which have their instructions in Japanese, for example. Right. But to go to the classroom situation, I think this is also true of I mean, you've been here long enough to speak some Japanese, but it's the whole idea, the native speaker's in front of a group of Japanese students and feels a bit excluded if they speak Japanese to each other. But the point is, if you put your students in group, there is some kind of outcome you require. It might just be, I always use the same example. When I first was made aware of this, a Spanish teacher at a conference in Spain, she basically said, I've been so fed up with all these British people who say, I've got to speak English all the time, and they have to speak English all the time. And I'm aware that my students kind of get alarmed about what they have to do. So she said, it's the days of cassette recorders. She had four tables, she put a cassette recorder on, and she said, switch them on now, I want to hear what you're doing in this task, you see. And it was really lovely, because she said, and then she played a tape, and she said, I want you to make a list of places where people work. And then in the tape that she played, one of the students said, ¿Qué tenemos que hacer? What do we have to do? This, I think, would be normal in any group. Yeah. That somebody, as long as they feel comfortable, can we just check that we all agree what we have to do? The second student said, tenemos que hacer una lista de trabajos. We have to make a list of jobs. And the third one said, no, I think we have to make a list of places where people work. So the first one said, I'll ask the teacher. And he said, profe. And she said, yes. He said, ¿Qué tenemos que hacer? She said, ask me in English. So the actual response to the teacher, he said, what we had to do? You know? And she said, you have to make a list of places where people work. And the third one said, tenía razón, I was right, you see. And then they start making a list of places, you see. Now, I'm sorry, but that is actually useful for them. They weren't mucking about. They weren't talking about the football on the television. They were trying to do the task. And the fact is, if in a situation like that, they'd all been forced to speak English. So in elementary class, what we had to get them together. You know that they'd want to speak Spanish. It helps, right? And it's a control thing. I mean, some minglers, for example, you might give them a task sheet of some kind where there's a question, you've got to ask questions of different people. You want that to be in English. Mm. It depends on the task. Mm. Everything depends on in this work, isn't it? You know, but at certain times, you put them in groups, and also, you know, it actually, you do learn via your own language, whether you're studying science, information technology, history, or a language. It's got to process it at some point through what you already know, which is your own language. Yeah, I mean, I know, I'm aware of the fact that a lot of native speakers are a bit askance at that.
In a British context, you know, when you have a multilingual class,
that's different.
Then that's a different thing. Yeah. And I think a lot of it comes from that.
Yeah.
But also, I think some of it comes from, in my experience, teachers who are really against using L1 in the classroom, perhaps their L1 ability is not as strong.
Yes, they're feeling a bit excluded.
My personal kind of policy in the class is that I don't speak Japanese in class, but if I listen to them, and if they're speaking Japanese, if they're on task, as you said, that's fine. I'm not that bothered. If they're talking about what they did yesterday, unless that's the task. But
and the whole point about group work is that once you approach that group, they'll go, oh, here he comes, we better start, you know. Yeah. And so it's actually a question of making sure you do visit the groups. It's as simple as that. Yeah. Group work is not, okay, get on with it, put my feet up.
Okay. Okay, thank you. And so one last question. You sold us the internet at the end of the plenary. You sold us the personal learning network of Twitter and so on. So there are, I mean, in the last two or three years, I suppose, it's Twitter has become a very important tool for educators and so on. And it's also a very democratic place. But there are a few kind of, well, for want of a better word, big names on the internet. So what's in it for you?
Well, speaking personally, I mean, it's interesting, the big name thing, I mean, I didn't go into too much detail, but for me there's a number of different things that are really very, as you say, democratic about Twitter. One is, you start off as a teacher in Japan, and you follow Scott Thornbury, Jeremy Harmer, you know, Stephen Krashen, there's all kinds of people you follow. Stephen Krashen, although he's on Twitter, doesn't really tweet very much as far as I can see. But, you know, and as we all know, Scott Thornbury tends to tweet pictures of his lunch, you know. And that's quite interesting. But occasionally, Jeremy particularly, will say something, or he'll take part in a little ongoing, you know, these, like, apart from the organised things, the ELT chat things, which are at a particular time, and it's an hour when people choose a subject, occasionally you'll get these kind of little things, like a whale coming out of the sea, where there's a conversation suddenly takes off, and you know, and you come in the middle, oh, I better go back and see how this started. Uh-huh. And somebody like Jeremy will say something, which some people might find a surprise. The advantage of following Jeremy Harmer, even if he doesn't follow you, is you can say, Mr. Harmer, I'm not sure I agree with that, or something, and you sit back going, oh my goodness, and then Jeremy, being the kind of guy who'll close, well, you know, if I've written more about this on a blog or something, he'll actually engage with somebody he's never met, somebody around them. That's the really democratic aspect of Twitter. Right, that's the first thing. The second thing, I think, is the ELT chat thing, the 1 hour on a particular subject. It's really a very useful, and it's just to sit there. I mean, even if you're just a lurker, you don't actually take part in the conversation, to see what people from all over the world are saying about a particular topic.
So I suppose for you as a materials writer, you want to know what your you know, your audience is thinking about and talking about is one of the reasons.
Yeah, I mean, there's not, what's in it for, I just think it's interesting. I don't know.
Well, it's rather an unfair question.
No, but there's no financial gain in being on Twitter. I don't think, to anybody.
No.
I do have a friend who lives in Brazil who works in tourism, and she started a new website about little places to stay, and she's a really interesting one, but she only ever tweets about her places.
Mm.
Try this place in this, I won't say what the name is because people might read it, but she constantly, her only tweets refer people to this website where are these nice little places to stay. And I think if she would just kind of say something more about what she's doing, it would break the fact that she's using Twitter to try and make a living, and it's not really the best form.
I had that discussion with someone yesterday, actually, talking about how to use Twitter as a business person, and I said, you know, people on Twitter sniff out a kind of a shill very quickly. They know if they're trying to be spammed or sold something.
But I think something else, and maybe this is just the way I do things. I'm not a very well organized person when it comes to my personal development, professional development. But you know, so I mean, I don't think, you know, I should read a bit more about task-based learning, or I should read a bit more about this, and I could go and get that. But I've got hundreds of methodology books on my shelf which I've never read from cover to cover. But what happens with Twitter is that somebody will have read one of Scott's A to Z of ELT things and said, Scott has just reached that, it's a really interesting blog. So you think, okay. And then just by accident, you'll have this kind of accidental bit of professional development by going to Scott's blog or somebody's like that. You know? And that's the other thing. I mean, Twitter as an access to blog world. And you know what? I mean, maybe it's just me being, I just get excited very easy about things. But to find all these amazing people, non-native speaker teachers all over the place, are doing fantastic work.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's one of them here, Vladka, you met her from Slovakia.
Yes.
You know, she writes the most wonderful blog. She lives in Slovakia, she teaches teenagers, and basically, you know, she says, I smile every day when I start work. And you think, that's a bit obvious, but the way she develops her classes, it's kind of profound and simple at the same time, and rather charming. You know, and I found a lot of people that I've collided with accidentally at conferences, or I've been referred to their blogs, and you just go, wow, that's a neat piece of writing, you know, it's lovely. It's kind of the access to this cornucopia stuff, if you want to go there, you know.
Okay, well, one final question. So you've finished writing Smart Choice, and now you're touring with it. So what are you working on in your shed at the moment?
I'm working on two projects. One is a primary project for Indonesia, which I'm writing with Mary Tomlin, which we've been doing for about 3 years now, and we're just finishing level 6. It's published locally by an Indian from Malaysia who has business interests in Indonesia. Lovely guy, and we were very taken with his plan to locally publish a book written by Western authors, so that's why we went for that
idea.
And I'm also working on a project with a woman called Jane Revelle. Do you know Jane?
That name sounds familiar.
Yeah, she's somebody I worked with many, many times over the years. And we're writing a rather unusual, it's like writing an advanced course book without any other levels, so you're not encumbered by regular features from previous years. It's purely advanced, and it has a kind of interesting, unique selling point that we're working on, using authentic videos of all kinds of stuff that is available through a website called Thought Equity. And you can have things like, if you want them, interviews with Obama, and kind of documentary material about earthquakes and stuff. There's some amazing stuff on there. And it's just a question of, and it's really nice because it's advanced. You can allow the video content to inform the language developments of the lecture. You know, you're not worried about, well, we are worried about language content.
We're
allowing the video stuff to provide us with our raw material for language development. So it's a really nice project.
Yeah, it sounds very nice. I'll have to look out for that.
Okay. Hasn't got a name yet.
Well, I'm sure it will have soon. Thank you very much, Ken.
Cheers, mate.
It's a pleasure.